Alex here again. Now lately I started to delve into 32-bit electronics for 3D printing. Now I jumped the gun a little bit with the Ramps Duo mod, or hack, whichever you prefer, but I'm okay with that because there are a couple goals of this channel. One is to provide information for people so that they have either an understanding or a mastery of the inner workings of their stuff, and the other is putting out projects and information just to stoke interest. So that Duo Ramps hack kind of falls in the category of adapting existing older technology to kind of work with some newer stuff. It was a nice way to kind of dip our toes into that world. But getting to the other purpose of this channel, which is getting out information, the data, and the nerdy details, I think it's time now to start another big long informational series. Kind of along the lines of the Ramps series, where I had a main subject, which was examining the Ramps board, and then branching off with different videos into like safety aspects and firmware, hardware, how MOSFETs work, all that type of stuff. And I've been prepping for this series for quite a while now. So here's the background. When I started looking at the state of 32-bit printing, I was thinking, hey, I'm just gonna toss up a video real quick with like kind of a status report on the whole thing and sort of answer some questions as to why this isn't more widespread. I kicked over a whole bunch of rocks and I found a whole bunch of worms. And each of those worms was carrying a can of worms. And it became evident that it was just gonna be more difficult than I thought just because of all the factors involved. So I continued collecting data, gave it a little bit of a time to stew, and thought about it a bit. Because at that snapshot in time, it seemed like we just had, like, deluxe boards, fancy boards, or kind of hacks or kludges around problems to adapt old stuff to new stuff, or cheap boards that were either quasi-functional or tied up with proprietary firmware and hardware, or were just more or less straight-up rip-offs of the more expensive boards with like cheaper parts and all the problems that go along with it, plus the entire headache of license violations and theft of intellectual property. So wading into that area was just a landmine. So the way I decided to approach the issue was instead of starting with what's there, which was sort of a derivative of what was hanging around, I thought, look, why don't I start from scratch, examine all the options that are available, see where the firmware is at, buy a whole bunch of parts to do experiments, and then if need be, poke my head onto various software and hardware developer forums to either offer a hand or just encourage people that were there and see if I could restoke interest in some of this stuff. But the impetus behind it is that I really feel that we should be pushing more into the 32-bit computing land than we are. But there are a couple reasons it's being held back. One is the lack of cheap components that are open, hackable, and well documented. Now that's all dependent on the manufacturers. But as it sits right now, the places that make the really cheap hardware aren't doing most of the development themselves. They're taking information that's already available and accepted in the community, and then manufacturing it on a massive scale and bringing the price down for everyone. But a big problem we're having is that that information just isn't there yet. There aren't a lot of designs out there. There's no new version of the Ramps Duo combo, at least not an affordable one, to be manufactured and have additional components and adapters developed for. Because there's kind of confusion about the software. There's a question about what's supported, what isn't, and how to get it running. Very few guides for this sort of thing, except what's scattered around in various pockets on the internet. And just not good documentation for the fundamentals on everything. And there's actually a whole bunch of cool opportunities out there that people just don't know exist. New things are going to have to come in, find some kind of quasi-standardization, or at least support on a wide scale, and then make its way into the mainstream consumer products. Now, I know there are a ton of boards out there still, some ranging from really cheap to some ranging to really expensive, and they vary between, like, completely open-sourced to, like, open-source non-commercial to semi-closed source to completely closed and proprietary. And I'll be touching on those various boards or platforms as time goes by. And regular watchers should know by now that I don't just take boards, give their price point and their features. So while I will be including some boards as examples, this is not just going to be a hardware overview of the market. We're not just trying to feed the commercial beast here. We're trying to change the freaking world. This series is going to be about going back to the basics and hopefully laying the foundation, if not paving the way, to support for more affordable electronics. Just like anything in the hardware world as it pertains to this, if you're willing to put in the research and the time, then you can piece together a system for yourself that's either sky's the limit in terms of quality and price is no object, or rock-bottom costs at the expense of some complexity and effort. As an example, I have a fully functioning 32-bit 3D printing setup that cost me about $25 to put together, not counting the kinematics and the motors. And that's an example of trading off features and ease of use for price. On the other end of the spectrum, there are very elegant, semi-walled garden systems that are already set up to work perfectly out of the box with their own firmware and the hardware that exists in their ecosystem. They also have very nice support and a warranty, but all of that also comes with a price tag and you're going to spend a couple $100 just on your electronics. Which is also fine if you have that kind of cash to splash around. Hey, support hardware development. That's great. Be an early adopter. So we'll be talking about those different approaches, the pluses and minuses, etc. What I can offer is enough information to put it in your hands so that the community can start kind of ruminating on it, and hopefully it'll spark some interest. Because sometimes in life there are insurmountable hurdles, either monetary or technology or something like that, but other times you just need a kick in the pants. So that's the goal here. A kick in the pants, a point in a particular direction, and enough information to where maybe if there's someone who's missing just one little piece, that they can finally say, oh yeah, we can totally do this. So we're gonna have to hit on firmware, the processors themselves, peripherals, how they're supported and why they may not be, external libraries that we can draw in, external libraries that may or may not work, how to configure all of this stuff yourself, how to choose what options you can and can't use, and various options for configuring the basic form factor of your project, pluses and minuses of different philosophies involved with that, a bit of examination with currently available options to compare and contrast, etc., etc., etc. So I spent countless hours going over all the different possibilities, trying out a whole bunch of things, blowing up a whole bunch of boards, to try to see what I thought would be the most promising. Because as I said, with all of that wide area to cover, with all of the potential pitfalls and problems that were going on, and all the people I might potentially piss off, I decided the best way to do it would just see what's out there, see what's cheap, see what's possible, and give it its due diligence to see what happens. So let's roll up our sleeves and get our hands nerdy. Get it? Nerdy? Dirt, never mind.